Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Ask Jochen. Welcome, welcome, and happy new year 2023. We're so thrilled to be here with you and to have a new session. Honestly, we have a ton of questions for today's Q&A, so I'm going to keep this intro very short. But as always, if you're tuning in, let us know where you're tuning in from. We always love to connect with you and let us know how your holidays went. And if you have any goals for the new year, we always love to connect with you guys and hear about your stories. And as I said before, we have a ton of new questions for Jochen this year or this episode. So I will not delay any further. Let's just play the intro sequence and then welcome Jochen into the session for today. Welcome, Jochen.
Hi, Mary Claire. Happy New Year. How are you?
Great. How are you? Happy New Year to you as well.
Well, yeah, thank you. Thank you. So the year is here. Lots of questions. This is why we do what we do. We're always trying to provide the answers. And I'm glad that, like you said, so many people now ask so many questions. That's what we do this for, right? We want to engage with our folks and want to give back to the community, and let's start.
Wonderful. Okay. So
before I get you to the first question, I want to welcome everybody. And for you folks who have seen this a couple of times, welcome back. I'm happy you are such a great followers and keep tuning in. And for all of you who have seen this now for the first time, what drove me to saddle making, saddle fitting is, of course, my best friend, my horse who took me to the German Championship and for the Olympic qualifiers. But unfortunately, long after he retired, we find out later it was actually a saddle problem. Today, this would not happen because people worldwide, together with us and individual different universities, different veterinarians, have developed an ethogram, how they can now identify when a horse is in pain, form a saddle. We have veterinarians who point out if the horse is ridden a certain way, of course the saddle will not fit. And look how the rider sits on top of the horse. So we see, even though they are veterinarians, they also say, well, where does the problem start? Does the horse have a sore back because of the way you train the horse or the way the rider sits on the horse? And then, of course, the myth. You know, one saddle fits all. You know, we have more and more veterinarians who talk about nerves. They talk about certain areas of the shoulder blade, certain nerves on the neck, what you can see here on this horse, and atrophy when the saddle doesn't move, not fit properly. You know, we hear people from shoulder freedom. What is shoulder freedom? You know, we see this exceptional horse, how it lifts the leg, how the shoulder comes back. We see veterinarians who do dissections. So we'd like to answer your questions, not so much with what my opinion or my experience is over the last 45 years, more so also what is out there in the industry from other professionals. In the end, we all want the same. We want to do the best for the horse. And we here at Schleese would like to provide a product what doesn't damage the horse, gives the horse the shoulder freedom. You know, this is a video many of you have seen before. For those folks who haven't seen this before, you can see here the shoulder moves back and forth and how the tricep contracts. This is slow motion for my horse. Rider sits further back. And all this we want to experience with a good saddle fitting. Okay, so while the technology is there with computerized saddle fitting, we want to help you to understand that you can ride your horse like the first horse. Not on the forehand, you want the front where the circle is. The forehand, you want that nicely light, back up. You want to have that uphill feel and not that downhill feel where the horse gets sore. So without further ado, let's go right into it and start with the first question, Mary Claire.
Great. All right. So the first question of the day is, how do Schleese saddles address the width for the full length of the saddle? So not just at the withers. And is this adjustable?
Right. The let me see. I'm just trying to find up something. Okay. Here we go. When we talk about tree width or shoulder or tree angle, very often it's a very big misconception. Here's a gullet plate. Let me just stop the sharing, for example. Okay, so here you see a gullet plate and you see a little bit how it's kinked in here. Okay, so from here to here, we identify that area. That's where we see the tree width. This is the narrow tree width where my fingers are, right? With a wide angle. Here's a narrow tree width with a narrow angle. You will see the top arc is almost identical on those. So we need to really identify when we said tree width. This is how wide the sidebars of the tree is. Let me see if I find one here. Here we go. Okay. How far are these two trees? So that would be in the withers. There was a two-part question. How do we address the tree width in our saddles? So we do it independently. You can just bring the tree angles in and out, or right here where the tree width is through the metal plate. You can have a narrow tree width, medium or wide tree width, and then below you can have a narrow angle or wide angle. So we do this two different ways at Schleese. We do it with a tree machine, and we use the gullet plate, what has a very thin material, a little bit heavy, but you can see how it's curved back, which is of course super nice if your horse has big shoulder freedom, like we're going to talk about. Just like all army saddle and all western saddle, the bars are always rounded backwards, and that's how Schleese uses them. So when the shoulder moves, it goes nicely away. So you can see here, we can use the metal. You see a couple holes here where the rivets were attached, and then you see another little, it looks like a screw. I don't know if the light can maybe shines better, maybe this way, right there. So this is the man-made weak area. So in this area, what I showed you with the other gullet plates, we can make that arc more like bell shape or more like an A. And then from there downwards up, that's where we change the angle. Now, how do we adjust the width front to back? So back to the saddle tree, not only on the withers, but also here. How do we adjust that in the width? Two different ways. It depends if the panel is an integrated panel or independent panel. If it's an integrated panel, in other words, the space, if we want to make that wider here, all the way for the horse's spine, you can see how the panel is stitched together in the back here. It's stitched to front and there. And you see here, in there is stitched together, okay? So what we can do, we can open this, we call these the gullet stitches. We can open these gullet stitches and create on an independent panel more space by taking the material, the leather, the panel leather, and wrap it more around. So we make a smaller panel width, but create a wider channel. Now you could say, oh, that's not good because now I have a smaller weight bearing surface and I have a horse that's already sensitive. Now I have less pounds per square inch. That's where the independent panel comes in. Let me see if I have one lying around here. Yeah, there you go. So that means each side has a separate panel. Okay, the sweat flap is not stitched on, and it's not stitched across from the left or the right. You have two separate panels. So here, we use on our saddles to 99% independent panels because we can take then the whole panel and move it more to the outside. Okay, so by moving the whole panel to the outside or the independent panel, we don't lose the width of the panel, therefore no less pounds per square inch. So that's how we adjust the tree width for the withers, and that's how we adjust the width all the way front to back. I hope that's the answer. Viewer was looking for.
That was perfect. Thank you, Jochen. So the next question is from Lori on Facebook, and she says, when you have multiple horses that share the same saddles, what is the single most important thing to take into consideration when determining which horse can wear which saddle? Or if it can't be narrowed down to one most important thing, what are the most important things?
Okay. So I like that you read the question in this order, because this was a nice segue, because we talked about the width all the way front to back. Here we see a panel with an integrated where the flap is stitched together. And here you see the rider. Let me just turn my camera off here so you can focus more on the picture at hand. No pun intended. Here you can see the rider, seeing how they measure the space. This gullet is too narrow. We need to make it wider in the gullet all the way front to back, or we call it spinal clearance. Now, this question was, what is important? What should it be? Always a minimum hand width, nice and wide, where the red bar is on top of the ribs, not on the spine, lumbar or shoulder blade. Okay. If you have a saddle for multiple horses, it is way easier if you start off with a nice wide channel, because if you have to have that for a round barreled horse, okay, it sits quieter, the saddle, if it doesn't roll from side to side. But if you also have a very narrow horse with a narrow spine, it is much, much easier to use another saddle pad or shimmable pads or thicker saddle pads. The second you use thicker saddle pads, it takes the space up in the gullet or in the spinal clearance. So start off with a bigger gullet front to back, because that allows you to help with different saddle pads to go from horse to horse. If it's too narrow, okay, you can't make it wider with another saddle pad. You only run into problems, spinal problems like we see all the time. So second, here you see what I talked earlier in the first question when I talked angle, okay? This is an angle device. This is an old fashioned tool. Sometimes we use it still, okay? It measures the angle. But if you look at the pen, okay, if you look at the pen top, the green to green, that's very wide. Where my thumb is here, just by looking picture to picture, you can see if my thumb would be where the green is, this is a much wider tree width. This is a narrow tree width. The angle is very much the same. So I always recommend, if you have a saddle for multiple horses, go with the wide tree width with a medium tree angle. Again, because you can pad up. You can use multiple horses on that saddle. Mary Claire, I just want to make sure I answer this question correctly. Would you read it one more time for me?
For sure. It's when you have multiple horses that share the same saddles, what is the single most important thing to take into consideration when determining which horse can wear which saddle?
Okay, so definitely the single one is the metal plate, because that metal plate allows the shoulder freedom. That metal plate sits right behind the shoulder blade and BL13, okay, respiratory health. If you want to avoid any problem with your horse when it comes to, well, this is the lung meridian point. If your saddle pinches, it's too narrow, has not enough room, the horse will have problems, you know. And we all know if the heart rate is elevated, you have cortisol level in the blood that only leads to stress. And horses with stress easier get colic and ulcer. So we definitely want to make sure we have plenty of spinal clearance. That's why the metal plate in the front is really, really important. I cannot stress enough, every saddle has a D-ring, okay? The distance from there to there, that's your tree width. Okay, here's the drawing again, okay? That is your number one what you're looking for. You could have a saddle all with medium tree width. The yellow is the distance tree width. And here the blue, the red, the green is a different angle. Here, red, 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 the same angle, but look at this. Narrow tree width, medium tree width, wide tree width. Go with a wide tree width, medium angle, then you will avoid the dry spots. You will avoid the pinching and the biting on those sensitive area on the horse, which I showed earlier with the nerve.
Excellent. Thank you, Jochen. Okay, so the third question we have here is, does widening saddle trees sometimes cause the saddle to rock? And if so, why? And if not, why not?
Okay. Think about a chair. When a chair's like a stool, maybe better, who has four legs. If you put it on the ground and one leg is shorter, it will wibble. Okay, or the front legs will be shorter than the back and will fall forward. On the saddle, I'm going to relate that on the saddle tree like the chair. I'm going to turn off my video and my screen share and show you. Okay, the saddle tree needs to sit, okay, on the points of the tree points, and the two parts on the back. So when we test a saddle, if the saddle tree is twisted, when we buy a saddle, it got to sit on the table flat, okay? It can't wibble. So if my horse underneath, okay, it's narrower than the angle, that's where the angle comes in, okay? So let's say my horse has the angle like my hand. I put my saddle on, and now you see the tip is off. The second you put your weight in your stirrup to rise or the horse moves, that will go down until the tip will fit and touch, kind of like tipping on the chair with uneven legs. So let's say you have a horse and the saddle fits perfect. And now you say, let's make the tree extra wide in the angle, okay, because I want to make sure he has lots of room. Now you widen it. Now you have no support on the bottom and the saddle will dive down in the front. It will tip. So yes, if you widen the tree wider than the horse's angle of the shoulders and the rib cage, then the saddle will rock and tip. If you widen it, because let's say this is the horse's angle and the tree was way too narrow and sits way too high, but now you widen it so it matches, okay? Now it has contact, it doesn't dig in, it has nice flush contact, then the tree does not rock when you widen the tree because you match that tree angle to the wider shape of the horse. So it depends, the answer to the question, it depends. If you widen it incorrectly, too wide for the horse, it will rock. If you widen it because the horse is wider than the angle of the tree, it will not rock. Some saddle companies, let me show you if I find one here. Okay, they have a different design. We stepped away from them because if you have a wood tree, would have a bar attached on the side, if I widen the tree here, that changes the rock of the bar. Okay, so then the whole curvature of the bottom. That's why we don't use wooden trees. We use a flex tree and an adapt tree where we can independently from the angle, the width, but also we can adjust the arc with the different spring steel we insert through here, because sometimes a horse goes through one saddle and the horse ages, and when they get older and still ridden, but the curvature is different, we need to change the arc of the tree, okay? So yes, the tree will rock if you have a wood tree or a tree what is not meant to be adjusted in the angle. No, the tree will not change in the rock. If you have a flex tree like this, I can change this back and forth. It makes no difference in the angle through here. So I hope that answer made sense to you guys.
That was great. Thank you, Jochen. All right. So the next question we have here is, when buying a used saddle, how can you tell if the tree is damaged? How much should the saddle bend? Adapt trees versus regular trees.
Okay. So if I'm looking through, let me see if I can find a good slide to demonstrate this or explain this better. Horses, hopefully are ridden so their back is up, haunches come underneath, and the weight comes off the forehand. But sometimes that's not the case. Sometimes the horse has body work, what definitely needs body work, but the horse doesn't, the owner has not chance to get to it, or nobody told them, or they don't know they can help, and the horse goes pretty inverted. Okay, so sometimes the horse gets ridden very well, but there is a lot of change. The horse has a lot of swing in the back. Okay, that is typical by Frisians. If you look how a Frisian's back moves, and you can relate, if you have a Frisian, you know exactly what I mean. It's like really up and down the back. So let's get back to the question again. When do I know the tree is broken? And how do I know it moves too much? And why are there different flexibility in the tree? Again, I'm going to stop the screen share and show you a tree. We start with the most common one, a beechwood laminated spring tree. And these trees are designed in the shape, in the making of the saddle is since the 1700s, pretty much the same. So old fashioned, but also very much heavy duty steel you see all the way front to back. You see it on the sides, okay? So that the wood tree doesn't break. So that tree is not meant to flex unless you weigh 180 pounds. That's the average male rider. So when you not 180 pounds, the tree will not move, will not give, even though this is a spring tree. What does a spring tree mean? That means that the horses will follow the shape of the back when you have the average weight of a rider before 1970. What's so special about 1970? Before 1970, the majority of the rider were male. Now you all know the majority of the rider are female. And in general, females are lighter than a male rider. So the most important aid we as the rider have is my seat. My seat is how I implement the aid to the horse. Do I really need to swing left to right to give the aids, or is it just a subtle movement through my seat, how I ride the half hold? As has been said in the past, if I stand up to show you more, a tree, an English tree, when you push it together, you will see it will move. Moves a little bit, okay? So let me take a saddle with the wood tree. Okay, and it moves a little. It doesn't throw a wrinkle. So in the past says, if you take a tree and you can move it together, it will throw a wrinkle. That is for a rider who weighs 180 pounds. If you, however, a rider who doesn't weigh 180 pounds and you are a little child and you want to use your most important aid, you are on the national team, say in Europe, there are lots of junior and young riders, of course, in North America too, who ride and take lessons in dressage. Mostly we use the seat more in dressage versus in other disciplines, but I want a saddle that follows the movement of the back. So if this is your most important aid and you don't weigh 90 kilos or 180 pounds, today, the industry has an option of an adapt tree. The adapt tree, as I said earlier, uses the spring steel. You can see the groove here. We put different size steel in here. Okay, so lighter the rider, so thinner the steel. The adapt tree, this is the nice part about saddle trees today. I can fold it in half, okay? It doesn't break the saddle. The tree is not broken, okay? Now, I don't want to ride in a saddle what folds a half. That defeats the purpose of distributing the weight, okay? So for every 50 pounds difference, the steel gets thicker. So if you weigh between 100 and 150 pounds, the flexibility, it's much, much softer than the wood tree I showed you, which is 180 pounds. Okay? So you will see on adapt trees or flex trees, you can easily move the seat and oh, there's wrinkles. Does that mean my tree is broken? No, that means if you understand, it's not a wood tree, it's an adapt tree, and it's made for a rider who's not 180 pounds, is around 150 pounds, that seat will flex much more. Now there are saddles, and let me see if I have one here. Get it out of the corner. Also in the Western industry, see, here's a Western saddle, they use flex trees, they can easily flex the cantle and the swell together. So there are certain saddles what calls flex trees. What I don't like about the flex trees, you can't change them in the width. You only do the angle. You can't do the tree width. What I like about the adapt tree, and this is why Schleese uses exclusively the adapt tree, we can change the angle, the width, we can do an orthopedic adjustment, which means if a horse is big on one side, he can open it without twisting the saddle. And the adapt tree, we can choose different spring steel. So we adapt to the rider's weight. So when the horse has a lot of movement or the rider gives the saddle aid, the two soles are connected, the horse and rider, but have the interface moving with the most important aid, your seat.
Wonderful. Thank you, Jochen. We have just a few minutes left. I can't believe already the time always flies.
I know.
We do these Q&As. Do you have time for one more?
Absolutely. Let's do it.
Okay, great. Let's do it. Okay, so this is from Tracy from BC, Canada. She says, as a shoestring budget horse owner / rider who can't afford a new Schleese saddle, I would like to consider buying a used one. Are there minimum must fit features that I could aim for when trying to buy used saddle or when trying used saddles and then work with the Schleese saddle fitter to adjust it?
Absolutely. The number one absolutely important part, what is to this day still taught at the Vienna Riding School, that's the oldest riding school in the world. It's over 400 years, and they still teach no rider, no seat, no rider. If the rider doesn't have a proper seat, you will not ever have the saddle fit the horse because the rider bounces all over the place and it doesn't sit quiet. Remember, like I said, more and more veterinarians, no point at the top. Look how the rider sits. No wonder the horse looks like this. So it has been said for centuries, not just decades, the saddle has to fit the rider first. It is important that it fits the rider first. So if you buy a used saddle, buy a saddle. If you're a female, please buy female saddle. If you're male, buy a male saddle. If the retailer doesn't know what you talk about, ask them. You have a saddle that fits me. They're going to look at you and say, yes. Sit in it, buy a pair of, have a jeans on. The jeans has a seam underneath, which riding pants don't have. Rock back and forth in the saddle and see if in the shop, or if the saddle comes out to your stable, sit in it, rock back and forth. If you feel the seam, don't buy it. It's a wrong saddle. Very, very easy, quick. The number one difference, the male saddle has a pointy crotch area for the male parts go left or right. The female saddle has a collapsed seat roof in the crotch area. No female likes to sit on the rooftop in the crotch. No guy wants to sit on the saddle where his parts can't go left or right. Remember, saddles are made by men, for men, since thousands of years. Only after the 1970s, we slowly make saddles for female. What's your question? What's the answer? What's number one? Fit yourself first. Once you get a good used saddle, Most Schleese saddles are fully adjustable. You might need a different panel, okay, but it's still cheaper than a new saddle. Okay, so fit yourself first, make sure you get the right saddle. And once you got the right saddle for you, all Schleese saddles can be independently adjusted in the tree width, tree angle. And as we said, we want to make sure that we get the shoulder freedom. Many people to this day still misunderstand what that means. That means you can see how the saddle here contacts the horse, but it doesn't dig in it, and how it easy can move without smashing the horse's body. Okay, so that's the number one rule. And like the first question was, have the right tree width, and the spinal clearance. Okay, most of that can be adjusted on the horse.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Jochen. Thank you for your time as always. And thank you to everyone for tuning in today. This, as always, will be on our YouTube channel for you guys to review later on. And we'll see you on the next live stream lecture later this month.
Thank you, Mary Claire. Can't wait.
Can't wait. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.